it's clearly going to be the basis of police powers if it's passed well into the next century. It's the view of myself and a number of others who've studied it very carefully indeed, that it erodes liberties far beyond the position that they're in now, and I think that the government are going to have something of a bumpy ride on this.
Good evening. Tonight, the controversial police bill, and with me, Mr. Patrick Mayhew, the Home Office Minister charged with piloting the legislation through Parliament. I think it is fair to say that the very first reactions to the bill may have surprised the government. Criticism coming not only from the expected quarters, but the unexpected too, like the Magistrates Association, the British Medical Association, and the churches. To set the scene now, Peter Gill reports.
The police bill has emerged from years of discussion behind closed doors in Whitehall, and a royal commission that set out to balance extended police powers with safeguards for individual liberty. In the event, say the critics, too many of the safeguards have been abandoned.
They will argue that any extra powers they're given are helpful to them. They would presumably argue that if they could go through everybody's house examining everything, that would be most helpful to them. But of course, one has to balance the police's powers in a free society against the liberties of individuals. These are a careful balance. It's the sort of balance that one looks to Parliament to maintain.
In a busy West London practice, Dr. Michael Wilkes has the confidential records of 5,000 patients on file. He saw the dangers of the police being able to examine those records.
I saw a patient of mine about a month ago who came to see me about a problem, which was that she had been, she'd had an affair in the past and had had a baby that had been adopted. She wanted to forget about all that. She was getting married and she wanted to have a child with her husband, but she didn't want her husband to know about the previous pregnancy. Now, that was information that she felt was very confidential and I would not reveal to anybody. Now, it's just possible one could perhaps paint a scenario where that patient, a friend of that patient, a relative, might be implicated in some crime and the police needed to know where she was at a certain time and they might come to me for help with that. If they went through my files and found out that piece of information about that patient, that's a weapon in the hands of the police. It's a weapon in the hands of anybody who might otherwise happen to have it revealed to them. And that sort of thing worries me.
Yeah, okay, thanks very much. Okay, you put that there.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Now, this evening, the Home Secretary and Mr. Mayhew have tried to cheer that doctor up because Mr. Whitelaw told the Commons that medical and other caring professions and their voluntary counterparts would find that confidential personal reports would be exempt from the provisions of the bill. And Mr. Mayhew, you, in fact, are also going to speak to the journalists about their problems, though whether you'll consider us a caring profession remains to be seen.
You have an interest, obviously, in confidences being maintained, and we understand that, and that's what has lain behind the announcement that the Home Secretary has made today. But we're all really on the same side, I think. The doctors have for a long time acknowledged a duty to help the police clear up serious crime. Equally, they've got this problem of keeping patients' confidences. And they and I, and the Home Secretary and the government, have the duty to work out how these twin and to some extent conflicting obligations can be married up. And I think that what we have arranged today meets their difficulties. I was glad to hear the response that the doctors gave, and I think it's right.
But do you now accept that you went too far to begin with? Why did you try it on?
Well, it's not a question of trying it on. The Royal Commission that reported on these matters recommended that there should be power for compulsory disclosure of confidentially held material in certain cases. There is at the moment in a number of very disparate and piecemeal statutes. They made no exception for the doctors. But we never intended, and the bill actually as drafted would not provide, that medical records would be disclosable under the provisions of the bill, save in very rare circumstances. But we listened to the anxieties. The doctor said, look, that may be so, but patients think that it will be otherwise. We've therefore decided to take the medical records completely out, but to keep in the things the police really need to get at, which are bullets taken out of bodies, bloodstained clothing that are needed for examination and so on, and they remain in.
It wasn't just patients, it was bishops and others too who thought that you were going too far. You've now accepted that.
Well, I quite see that they believed that the bill is going to do more than actually it was. Therefore, why not make it absolutely clear? As the Home Secretary said today, for the avoidance of doubt, making things absolutely clear, we're going to say that the bill will not apply at all to records. But what the police do need to do is to be able to get at evidence of really serious crime. That the public need, we're worried about the increase in crime, the Royal Commission was worried about the inadequacy of the powers, and we've got to meet that anxiety.
I'm sure that it'll bring a lot more work to criminal lawyers, because many more people are going to find themselves arrested, and many more people, having been detained for some long period at a police station before they're induced to make a confession, a true or false confession, are probably going to be challenging those confessions in the criminal courts.
What about the matter of access by a solicitor like yourself to a client? Does it affect that in any way?
Yes, because it provides that there is no access during the first 24 hours. If the police feel that it's a serious offence and that the defendant should therefore be detained for 36 hours before being brought before a court, again there's no access, but one would think that if the offence is sufficiently serious to merit that further detention, the defendant ought to be able to seek legal advice. But no, he's not able to. At present, the law provides that the defendant may see a solicitor on request, provided it doesn't conflict with the interests of justice. Well, I hope it's not unduly cynical to say that many lawyers feel that police tend to say that if the defendant hasn't made a confession, it probably is conflicting with the interests of justice if he sees a lawyer.
Well, Mr. Mayhew, there are a number of points to be gone through there. First of all, would you accept that it's important for the police not to create difficulty with the community that they're meant to be protecting, and that the new rights to stop and search will do just that?
Of course I agree that it's important that they shouldn't create difficulty, but I would suggest to the critics of the bill that there is considerable difficulty for the police in the eyes of the community if they are not able to stop and search somebody whom they reasonably suspect is carrying a weapon which the law for the last 30 years has made it an offence to carry in a public place.
But, of course, you can search a lot of people who are not carrying a weapon.
Well, you can only do it if you reasonably suspect that they are, and that can be checked up on. Now, let me just say what the bill does by way of safeguards. It requires that a police officer shall say who he is. It will require that he shall say what station he is attached to. It will require that he says what he is looking for. It will require that he explains why he is looking for it. It will require him to make a record of what takes place. It will require him to tell the suspect that he will make a record, and it requires him to tell that suspect that he is entitled to a copy of that record at any time in the next 12 months.
And do you think that on a dark night in Toxteth or Brixton, policemen will do that?
Yes, I do. But I would also just ask people to think about this. We hear a great deal about the resentment that can be caused to somebody being asked to empty his pockets to show whether or not he is carrying a weapon. A certain amount of resentment is caused to people who are hit over the head in the street. A certain amount of resentment is caused to people who are told by the police, I'm sorry, but we simply don't have the power to search in England. In Scotland they do. In Scotland they've had it for the last 2 years. And do you know that during the first 10 months, one third of the people stopped were found to be carrying offensive weapons?
Yes, but two thirds were not. And say, for example, in the searches for drugs, is it not true that something like 75% are not carrying illegal drugs?
How much of a risk, how much is it right for the government to take risks with other people's safety? Let us take the case of an old lady who's hit over the head with a cosh. I mean, after all, that's a fairly frequent occasion, unhappily, and people are frightened about this. Is the government entitled to take a risk and say, I'm sorry, but we're not going to give the police power to search? Because, you know, although in Scotland one-third of the people whom they search are found to have them, two-thirds haven't. Now, I believe that most people in this country would say, you've got nothing to fear. If you are searched in a courteous way, or stopped and searched in a courteous way, it's explained to you why this is being done. It's in everybody's interest that it should be done. I mean, it's a matter of judgment, I quite agree, but I know where my judgment lies, and I believe I'm supported by the country.
Is it true that if, say, a young man throws a bus ticket or a cigarette pack down in the street, and a policeman stops him and talks to him, and that young man refuses to give his name, or there may be something wrong with the name and address that he offers, he can then be arrested.
What you're talking about there is something quite different.
It's also here, in the bill.
No, well, it's in the bill, but I'm just making the point that it's a quite different thing, which I'm very happy to deal with. Now, what the bill does is to provide a law of arrest that makes general sense and is a simple and easily understood law in the place of the present, extremely complex one. We follow what the Royal Commission recommend. Now, where an offence is committed, which isn't an imprisonable offence, and therefore is not one that can be arrested without a warrant, nevertheless it is committed, and the bill says, you shall deal with this by summons if you can. In other words, don't arrest him, but deal with it by summons. But the bill also says that if the man or the woman makes it impossible for you to serve a summons by giving his name as Mickey Mouse, well then, no longer are you going just to have to stand there and wave him goodbye as he bicycles away. You will be able to arrest him so that you can find out how to serve a summons. Now, doesn't that make sense? I know you're not allowed to answer the questions, but I ask the question rhetorically. I think that the public expect us to make sure that the law isn't made a laughingstock, and if there is a trivial, let it be a relatively trivial offence, but if it is an offence, and the police wish to summon somebody, then surely they haven't got just to stand there while he disappears and say, well, what a pity I haven't got a power to arrest him.
Yes, but it's not always Mickey Mouse, is it? There are examples, aren't there, of perhaps inexperienced young policemen, a lot of young policemen in central London, who do harass young black people, homosexuals, people like that. Is that not also a serious consideration for you in extending these powers?
That is very wrong when it happens. And you can never legislate to prevent the abuse of a particular power or a discretion. Now, what we have to do is to establish a fair balance. We have to provide the police with powers that they reasonably need to protect the public. We ask them to do that. And when street crime, for example, goes up, then everybody gets very worried about it. And you and I know that very well. Equally, we have to ensure that the right of the citizen not to have his liberty infringed is kept as much as is possible. And it's a difficult balance that has to be maintained. We are greatly helped by the Royal Commission. We're doing very largely what the Royal Commission recommended.
Well, some of the members would say not, but just one thing. Is it not an infringement of the liberty of the individual that he can now be held in a police station so long? And is it not a fact that juries are refusing to convict when confessions are produced, especially after people have had a long time in a police station?
Well, let me deal with the present...
Is that not a problem for you?
Yes, of course it's a problem. But let me deal with the present law before we come to the bill. Under the present law, if a policeman thinks an offence is serious, he is allowed to keep somebody in the police station before he's charged, provided that he brings him to a magistrate's court as soon as is practicable. Now, 4 years ago, there was a case of somebody who was kept for 7 days and 3 hours before he was charged. He was then charged with murder, and he was ultimately convicted. Now, that's under the present law. What this bill does is to restrict the present powers. It does not extend them. What it does is to require that there is a magistrate's court that has to warrant further detention after 36
hours.
Certainly, but there's no requirement for that at the moment. Under the present law, a police officer doesn't have to bring somebody before a magistrate's court for further detention.
Your first thought is 24 hours in the bill.
Well, wait just 1 minute at a time, if I may. I'll come to that. Certainly. What we at first thought was that at 24 hours, there should be a requirement that a magistrate sitting alone should warrant further detention. Well, we listened to what we were told by the Magistrates Association. They said, we don't want to do this. We think that this is difficult for us, and sitting alone and not hearing the other side, not hearing the suspect, we don't think that's fair. Well, on reflection, we agreed. So we said, very well, it shall be a magistrate's court and not a single magistrate. There shall be a right for the suspect to make his case known, for him to have legal aid, and that shall take place not later than 36 hours. There's nothing like that in the present law, so this is a very marked improvement in the libertarian sense, and it is a restriction on the present, very uncertain and extensive powers for detention.
Well, we've looked, Mr. Mayhew, at some of the specific causes for concern that people have put forward about this legislation. But there's also, I think, a wider theme, issues involving the role of the police in a democratic society. And that was the point that Peter Gill put earlier to Mr. Peter Archer, who was, of course, Solicitor General in the last Labour government.
Mr. Archer, why is it that the Labour Party, like so many other bodies, finds this bill so objectionable?
Well, to put it very shortly, for two reasons. First, because it doesn't achieve the objective which it sets itself. We're all in favour of law and order. We all want to see the police effective. We all want to see people who've committed offences brought to justice. But that depends upon the police enjoying the cooperation of the public, and of the public in the particular areas where these things happen. Young people in inner city areas. Now, this bill is going to produce more occasions for aggravation. It's going to alienate the police from the public yet further, and it's going to make their job more difficult. The second reason is because it doesn't achieve, again, what it says it sets out to achieve, to get the balance right between making law and order effective and the rights of the individual. The purpose of the Royal Commission was to try to put together a package which would get that balance right. Now, not everybody agreed with the package. But what this government has done is to take out of the package just those particular elements which they want to see in and leave the rest out altogether so that it doesn't achieve the balance which the Royal Commission itself wanted to see.
In reality, though, is it doing very much more than simply formalising what happens in police stations and what the police do on the streets up and down the country?
Well, even if that were so, it wouldn't be very satisfactory, because what I gather the government says is that it's formalising what happens already. Now, there are a great number of complaints about what happens already, some of them from the police themselves. What we ought to be doing, and what the Royal Commission tried to do, was to look at what ought to happen, not at what is happening. But if it is going to take what is happening already, it does that and then removes the safeguards so that it doesn't even achieve that either.
Do you think these amendments that have been announced today in the House of Commons will make any difference to your and your party's attitude towards the bill?
Well, they're obviously to be welcomed. Exactly how far they meet the criticisms which have been made will emerge when we see precisely what the amendments are. But I think it's worth saying that these are amendments to those parts of the bill which attracted an articulate lobby. Now, they are very important parts of the bill, and thank heaven people were found who criticised them. But there are other parts of the bill which didn't attract the same articulate lobby, because the only people who will be affected will be kids in inner city areas, all the people who aren't in a position to articulate a lobby. Now, those haven't been touched.
But we all have a duty, don't we, to ensure that the police have the means to do the job they've got to do?
Very much so. We're all on the same side about this. What we complain about is that this is going to make the police's job harder and not easier.
Mr. Mayhew, why didn't you put in the safeguards, like tape recording interviews in police stations, that the Royal Commission wanted?
Well, the Royal Commission recommended that tape recording should become the normal practice. The Home Secretary has said that he accepts that in principle. We have set in train in six police areas pilot schemes to work out the practicalities of this. There are some people who don't want tape recording. I have always wanted it very much, but I'm determined that we should work out the practical snags before we go nap on a particular method, because if we build into the system defects, there are plenty of people who would say, now we told you so, and the whole thing should be scrapped. So that's the first thing. May I just say one word? I was very surprised to hear Canon Walker earlier, who was doing such a marvellous job in Lambeth, saying that he thought the bill would be harmful, because one provision of the bill, which we haven't mentioned tonight, requires police authorities to set up statutory arrangements for consultation with the public, between the police and the public, so as to get the opinion of the public known and the cooperation of the public for the police. Now, that is something which the Royal Commission didn't recommend, but which we've put in. And there are many other instances where we've established that sort of balance.
But given all these extended powers, are policemen any longer citizens in uniform, or are they now a special and specially privileged group?
You bet they are citizens in uniform. What privilege does this bill confer upon the police? Not much of a privilege to have to go out on a dark night and search somebody who may be carrying a weapon, but we require them to do that. I've noticed Peter Archer saying there wasn't any attention made to people who criticised stop and search, for example. It is a very different matter. Lord Scarman, in his report on the Brixton disorders, said he was convinced that the powers of stop and search recommended by the Commission and now in the bill were central to the police for the combating of street crime. We're out to protect people against street crime. We're out to protect them against rapes. I know that people said, well, our liberties are infringed. That liberty does require that you should be able to walk down the street without being mugged, get home and find you've not been burgled, find that your daughter has not been raped. This is what we have to do, and we have to achieve it without unnecessarily infringing personal liberty. That's the balance this bill strikes.
Are you going to get this bill before the general election?
We are going to take this bill through the House of Commons, and I believe it will be carried in the House of Commons. I believe it will be carried in the House of Lords, and the country will say, well done.
Thank you, Mr. Mayhew.
Thank you.